Good morning, everyone. With hearts full of gratitude for the blessings of God, welcome to worship on this Thanksgiving Sunday. We welcome those who are listening in on our television broadcast, and we invite everyone to join us for a time of fellowship and tea following our worship today. A thank you this morning to Bev Simpson of Vessie Seeds for the pumpkin and gourds and vegetables that are decorating our sanctuary this morning. It's lovely to have that in front of us to help us recognize this special day. I would draw your attention to the announcements that are printed in your bulletin. I would encourage you to please take time to read through them and to see which ones specifically pertain to you. I would like to acknowledge that today's bulletins are in loving memory of Tom McDonald, presented by Joe Sheaves. A happy birthday to Callum McKinnon and to Earl Jewell, celebrating their birthdays this week. Please read through some of the events that are taking place and meetings that are happening here at Trinity over the next couple of weeks. There are some study groups happening already. Greg is leading one, what's it called? Saving Jesus. And starting next week on Thursday the 20th, I will begin a study around the remits that the United Church of Canada as a whole must look at and members must vote upon. So that will be starting on Thursday the 20th. I have one announcement that is not printed in your order of service, and that is that the Trinity Clifton Joint Search Committee has a report to present to the congregation. It will be presented on Sunday, October 23rd, immediately following worship. Therefore, we are calling a congregational meeting after worship on October 23rd, 2016. So please note that date in 2 weeks' time. So it is also, we are pleased to welcome today into the church by baptism, Paige Lauren. And so we will be celebrating the sacrament of baptism today. This morning, I would also like to introduce to you Allison Kelly, who is going to be working with our youth and music. And Allison would like to introduce herself and share some information about that program with you.
Hi.
You need a mic.
Project with my singing voice, but I guess this works too. After a few delays, I'm going to start working with the children next week after service. Before we know it, the white gift service is going to be just around the corner, so I'd like to get started on a few things, get the kids singing, get them a little bit more involved in the services in the morning. If you wouldn't mind, I would really love to meet some parents after the service is done, and some kids if you're around as well, just to kind of get an idea of what kind of age ranges I'll be working with and how many I'll be working with. So that'd be much appreciated. Come say hello. I'll just probably be over here at the end of service. Okay? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Allison, and welcome. Welcome to Trinity. Already got it. Let us acknowledge the light of Christ as we begin our worship. As the cycle of the year comes to a close, the nights get longer and the days cooler. With this flame, a light in our hearts, we go where Christ's light shines.
Hallelujah. Amen.
We gather this morning to celebrate the harvest home. We gather with hearts filled with gratitude as our senses take in all that we have received. For the bountiful blessings in praise and thanksgiving.
Let us worship God.
Let us join in singing hymn number 227, For the Fruit of All Creation. Let us join in prayer. From our hearts, with our hands, through our voices, in our love, we thank you, God, for every sunrise and sunset, for every smile and tear, for every moment that has passed, and for every moment yet to come. May our thanksgiving fill the world with gratitude and joy. Amen. I would like to invite the children to come and gather at the front as we sing together our baptismal hymn number 445 in Voices United.
Thank you.
This morning, we enjoy and celebrate the sacrament of baptism. Following the tradition of Jesus who welcomed children into his community, we celebrate the presence of children within this community of faith and offer to children the sacrament of baptism.
On behalf of the congregation of Trinity Clifton United Church, I present Paige Lauren for initiation into the body of Christ through the sacrament of baptism.
Hi there, how are you? Is that? Okay, no, that's fine. I have a few questions for you this morning, and also questions for the congregation as well. Do you desire to have your child baptized in the Christian faith? If so, please answer, we do, God being our helper.
We do, God being our helper.
Will you encourage your child to learn from the wisdom of the prophets, doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly with her God? If so, please answer, we will, God being our helper.
We will, God being our helper.
And will you foster for your child an appreciation for the life and teachings of Jesus? If so, please answer, we will, God being our helper.
We will, God being our helper.
Will you journey with God's Spirit to enable your child to discover the wonder and the beauty of God's everlasting love? If so, please answer, we will, God being our helper.
We will, God being our helper.
I would ask the congregation to please stand. Jesus calls us to welcome children into the full life of our community, opening our table and hearts to those most vulnerable, offering the wisdom of ages to all who hunger for truth. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise your love, support, and care to this child being baptized as she lives and grows in this Christian community? And so respond, we promise our love, support, and care. May we all join together in a confession of faith, the new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Would you pass the water, please? The congregation, please be seated. We'll handle that pretty good. Here we go, we'll put it there for now. We thank you, God, for the gift of creation made known to us in water and in word. Before the world had shape and form, your Spirit moved over the waters, and out of the waters of the deep you formed the firmament and brought forth the earth to sustain all life. In the time of Moses, your people Israel passed through the Red Sea waters from slavery to freedom and crossed the flowing Jordan to enter the land of promise. You have come to us through water in the stories of Jesus, who was nurtured in the water of Mary's womb, baptized by John in the water of the Jordan, and became living water to a woman at the Samaritan well. Jesus washed the feet of the disciples and sent them forth to baptize with water and the Spirit. Would you help me pour this water? Bless by your Holy Spirit, gracious God, this water. Bless all who touch and taste water, that they may be ever reminded of your abiding presence and claim on their lives. Amen. Okay. Hi there. Oh, yeah. How you doing? What's the name of your child? Paige Lauren. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the congregation said, Amen. With the cross, with the sign of the cross, you are claimed as Christ's forever. And the congregation said, Amen. Come on over. Let's put hands on Paige. There we go. Hey. There we go. Paige, Lauren, the power of the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful witness to God who created you. Amen. I'm going to walk Paige, Lauren, down into the congregation as a symbol that she is now within the community of Christ, as we all are. Hi, Paige. Give you some stuff. May the light shine in you and through you into the world. Let us pray. Was that you? Yeah.
Let us pray. God of wonder and grace, we thank you for your love revealed this day. As this community, these parents, and this child come together making covenant promises, we pray that this community will have the grace to uphold the promises made, providing a safe shelter of your love in which this child may grow and play. We pray that these parents may continue to feel the sweet wonder of your presence, so transparent here today. We pray that this child will bask in your love as she makes her own journey through this life. Amen. Amen. We'll join in singing the baptismal benediction. It's Voices United 454.
great kiddo, though. Both of them.
Thanksgiving Day provides us an opportunity for us to take stock of God's blessings and to reflect on our own response to those blessings. Let us pray. Our Creator, you have made an intricate and diverse world and set us to cultivate it reverently and responsibly. O Creator, you have made a world of abundance and intend for us to share so that all may have their daily bread. O Creator, you have sent us Jesus, the bread of life, to satisfy our spiritual hunger and thirst. Every day and all day, let us celebrate your goodness. Every day and all day, let us shape our very lives by focusing our minds on what is beautiful and worthy of praise. We have offered to God the concerns of our hearts and minds. We trust that God not only hears our prayers, but in God's almighty wisdom and awareness of our needs does answer our prayers. We are a forgiven people. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I would like to share with you some stories of people who, in the journeying of life, saw the presence of God and decided to write it down. Happened long ago in what we call the Hebrew Scriptures and in the Christian Scriptures, commonly known as the Old and New Testament. And so the first story that I want to share with you is from Deuteronomy, chapter 26, verses 1 through to 11. Let us allow these words not only be words printed on a page or words out in the air, may they be like a gentle rain up on our hearts and our lives, and may we be nourished by the stories of old. When you have come into the land of the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God has given you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in the office at the time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." And when the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramon was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in years, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us, they imposed hard labor on us. We cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. I would invite you to now share in a responsive psalm, which is Psalm 100, and it's found on 824 in Voices United.
Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing.
Shout to God, all the earth. Come before God with laughter. To the shepherd who tends us like a sheep. Come to God's gates with thanksgiving. Praise and bless God's name. You are always gracious.
Rejoice, rejoice, give thanks and sing.
And our last story this morning from Sacred Scripture is from Luke 17. Let us hear what Luke has to say to us. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through a region between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy upon us." And when he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean, but the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And then he said to him, "Get up, go on your way. Your faith has made you well." May these readings sit with us, filter through us, and be part of our lives that gives life and hope and the presence of the Holy. Amen. Let us take a moment in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we dance with words and thoughts. We ask this morning, as I dance with words and thoughts, that somehow in some wondrous way your Spirit will mingle those words and allow us to hear what we need to hear. May, O God, your presence be felt in the words that are spoken and the words that are not spoken, our lives that are laid open to the possibilities of life that comes to us. May you be present to us, O God. We ask it in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. You know, one would think that creating worship and preparing worship for Thanksgiving would be just a wonderfully easy thing to do. It should be easy. Look around our country, look around our province, look around our community, and there's so much to be thankful for. There's so many things to be thankful for. We live in affluent countries around the world. And even those who are poor do not have the same level of poverty that we see in other areas of the world. Thanksgiving Sunday never sits easy with me. There's always something gnawing at me when we gather for worship and give thanks. There's something about that, with our lots of produce all around, wonderfully decorated, by the way, by our worship committee. But there's something about this time that just gnaws away at me. I have so much, we have so much by the world's standards. And I've got to ask myself, what am I doing with that? How am I being responsible, a responsible steward, that I have so much and we have so much as a people? What do we do with that? What exactly today are we giving thanks for? Are we giving thanks for all the good stuff that's happening to me? Because that seems to me a real focus on the I, the me, which I think is so contrary to what we see in the stories of Jesus and in the writers, how they understand the God whom Jesus worshipped. Now, I'm well aware that Thanksgiving has its roots in the good that comes from the earth, and we attribute that comes from God. Not that God has favored us, not that God has given this to us and said, you are a chosen people, you will be better than anybody else, not that at all. The early settlers were thankful that at harvest time, because a good crop meant they would eat during the winter. Life for another season. That's something to celebrate, don't you think? The gift of a good crop was attributed to God's kindness. God looked favorably upon them. That thinking makes good sense. God is being good to me. God has given me stuff. Well, it's good sense until there is a poor crop and the season following is a season of death because of scarcity and no food. But that's a sermon for another day, another time. Last week, one of the treasures that I have And one of the wonderful gifts that is given to me as being a minister is I meet with people, and people allow me into their lives to hear their stories, to be part of their stories. Sometimes it's really, really good stuff. It's all good stuff, but sometimes it's challenging, sometimes it's joyous, sometimes there's tears and laughter. But that's a privilege when people invite me to be part of their lives, and I take that seriously. Last week, I had a wonderful opportunity to sit with an elderly woman, a very wise woman, and she reflected on her long life, and she said, you know, Greg, sometimes I used to say, I have had a good life. I've had a really good life. I've lived into my old age, and I've had a really good life. And she said, I don't say that anymore. I don't say that anymore because the I says it's all about me. It's all about my life. It's all about the good things that happened to me. And she said, you know what? Life and happiness and goodness is greater than that. She said, I prefer to see my life now as I have shared and as life has been given to me by others. It's not all about me. Life is not about me, and sometimes Thanksgiving gets perverted by looking at life how God has blessed me, how God has blessed my country, how God has blessed my family, and usually that's seen in the way that we've accumulated wealth, in how much food we have, and all those sorts of things. I think we all realize that where we are today, where we've been born, is an accident of birth. It has nothing to do with God saying, you know what, I'm going to put you in this place and I'm going to put you in that place. I'm going to have you go and forage for food out in the dump, or I'm going to have you forage or look for food up at the market. God doesn't do that. We are here by an accident of birth. We have good things by an accident of birth. And the question about that, with that is, what now? What do we do with that? What do we do with that abundance that we have? I don't think it's enough for us simply to thank God. I don't think it's enough for us to say, yes, God, this has been good. It's like the person getting on the elevator and the person says, well, how are you? And really, they don't really want to know how are you. It's just conversation. Thanksgiving can't be like that. It's not glib like that. In our Bible study this past week, Saving Jesus, and if you get an opportunity to come out, it's Tuesday mornings, 12 to 1, and I try to keep it within that length of time. A wonderful group of people gathered this past week, and one of the things that we talked about is how Jesus has been understood, or maybe more rightly, misunderstood over 2,000 years. The movement of following Jesus moved from the early years, which was right action, doing the right thing, to doing the right thinking, the right believing. To be a follower of the way, follower of Jesus, all that you needed to do under the right belief was to think right thoughts. It was to think right beliefs. Believe properly, and your skids were greased for heaven. Believe improperly, and your skids were greased for hell. No action required. Just believe, be saved, and sit until you die and enter the promised land. That was a form of thinking, and it's still the form of thinking. You don't know how many times I've been asked, have you been saved? You need to say a few words to say that you are a saved person. But you know what? I believe we are all saved in Jesus the Christ. We're saved in a way in which there's nothing we can do on our behalf to accept that it's there. That's unconditional love.
That's love at its fullest. That's love at its greatest moment. To be able to feel that there's nothing else that I need to pay, God still accepts me who I am and where I am. Our worship of thanksgiving is never enough. Our once Sunday a year at harvest time is not enough. Our reflections on our lives and giving thanks are never enough. There has to be more. You know, I keenly remember when Ellen and I decided to begin to have children. It was fun preparing for the arrival of a new child. And you know, we had it down pat. We were prepared. Well, we weren't prepared for our first child. And you know what? I've not met a couple who has ever been prepared for their first child. Patrick was born, and we were very thankful for our first little guy, as we were very thankful for our second little guy, Timothy. Being thankful, though, wasn't enough. It's nice to be thankful, but there's got to be more. The birth was a big event. Bigger for Ellen, really, than me. But it was only one event in a long line of events on a journey that's been full and exciting, with tears and laughters, with pains of growth and long discussions, with up at midnight waiting. It's a life that is continuing. Patrick was born. What then? Timothy was born. What then? There needs to be action, of course. There were late nights of feeding. There were nights of trying to settle them with a cold or a flu or some type of illness. Those were part of the course. They were extra. They were things beyond this wonderful birth. And as any parent knows, there's a lot of action along the life of a child. The birth is the tip of the iceberg. The two-thirds of the iceberg sits below. The celebration and thanksgiving is that small piece of iceberg you see up here. The work of thanksgiving is something greater below and something that cannot be ignored. We can see the same process, the journey, when the water of baptism is poured. It's a time of great thanksgiving. You betcha it is. Of celebrating a new life. It certainly is. The joy and thanksgiving of a moment that is beautiful and wonderful. These moments, of course, open up our lives to actions of love and care. It just doesn't stop here. It continues to grow and to nourish, both on behalf of the parents and their family and the larger group who's gathered called the community of faith who journey with this child. We do this not out of duty, but out of love. Our lives extend beyond this day of thanksgiving to loving actions expressed in our communities. And you know what? We do that well. We do that well here. Expressions of love truly reflect being a thank-filled people. And actions speak louder than words. Our gospel storyteller Luke shares an interesting story. Jesus heals 10 lepers. Jesus instructs them to go to the temple in Jerusalem as the law requires. 9 of them obey Jesus and head off for Jerusalem, but one of the cleansed lepers disobeys Jesus and instead returns to give thanks. And in reality, in Jesus' time, that would have been very disrespectful. 10 behaved like good lepers, good Jews, and only one behaved like a man in love, broke away from the customs, broke out of what he should have done, ought to have done, and really relied on the sense, not of obligation, but a sense of love deep, recognized in the person. We are good
at following expectation and following rules. Darn it, I'm good at following expectations and following rules. There is an expectation about attending church, of doing and thinking the right things. That's not all bad. But that in and of itself is never enough, cannot be enough. Our thankfulness cannot be dependent upon what's in our bank account or on our table this Thanksgiving Sunday. Our thankfulness needs to go to the source of life itself. Because we are privileged, because we live in a very good part of the world, doesn't mean that God favors us or looks on us any better. The tendency when things are good is to say, I, me, self, self, self. As we give thanks this day, my hope and my prayer is that our thankfulness will be rooted deep in a love of unconditional love. That it'll be rooted in a sense of our lives given to God and our expressions of love given to each other. May the glory and the love of God surround us this day and hold us forevermore. Amen. Will you join with me if you are able and sing our hymn, which is 522, Give Thanks, My Soul, for Harvest.
The scriptures tell us to make a joyful noise, to come into God's presence with singing, and give thanks and bless God's name. This we can do. We can thank God for the bounty we have received, and we can return to God a portion of our blessing. We need only to be joyful in our thanksgiving. The offering will now be received. us join together in prayer. Fill us with gratitude, O God. From you all blessings flow. To you all gratitude shall return. Fuel us as a gracious people, full of your spirit, led by your way, overflowing with compassion and power to shape our lives and your world for good. Amen.
Will you join with me in prayer? Let us pray. On this day, O God, we give thanks in all kinds of communities, or maybe in solitude as well. Our desire in this moment is to come before you with our prayers of thanksgiving. For some of us, the words we offer will flow easily from our lips. For others, trying to name our blessing may prove difficult and hard. Thanksgiving 2016 may be very different from previous years. A new table at which to sit, new persons sitting with us, or a dear one absent. Worries crowding out our sense of blessing. These realities may reshape our prayers from years past. To seek joy may lead through heartbreak. Whatever our reality, O God, we ask that you help us focus not so much on material things, whether they are abundance or scarcity, but rather on how we are living our lives in relation to you and to each other. Help us to recognize all the ways you are present in our life this year. Help us to gather the strength we need for today and for all of our tomorrows, realizing that life is a fragile gift of which we journey. Grant us the satisfaction of intimacy with the Christ and with God. Help us, O God, to celebrate the gifts that we have happened upon. And may we, O God, never be so smug as to say, it's all about me. And so as we gather this day in worship, and as we leave here to go to whatever place that brings us life, we ask, O God, we might find there your presence, your spirit. Be with us, O God, as we continue to celebrate our faith beyond these stone walls into the world that is awaiting for us. And now we say a prayer that's found in Scripture and a prayer that's been attributed to Jesus, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Will you stand and join, if you're able, in our final hymn, which is 520 in Voices United, We Plow the Fields.
Thank you.
Today in our prayers around tables, may we discover what is beautiful and call it a blessing. May we recognize the way in which our lives are intertwined with the lives of others and with all of God's creation. May we be bold to praise God with our thanksgiving. Go in peace. Amen.